Hi, I'm Kassian Rosner Wren, and today we're going to talk about V8, WebAssembly, and the future of JavaScript and a multi-language web. A little bit about me. I am a robotics author slash addict. I am a developer advocate at Cloudflare, and I Twitch stream hardware and software at Node.Botanist. I'm on a bit of a hiatus right now, but I'll be back later this year slash early next year as I get a lot of my affairs in order. I also have two wonderful cats. The one on the left is Ace. If you hear any meowing in today's presentation, that'll be Ace. And on the one on the right is Arya. And those are my babies. So I find the best way to start saying what WebAssembly is by saying what it isn't. So we're going to talk a little bit about what it isn't before we talk about like the definition of what it is and moving forward with the implementation of it. So what WebAssembly is not, it's not just a programming language or an instruction set. It's so much more than that. It's not the death of JavaScript, probably. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And it's not something you can just ignore because it's going to go away. You can't just pretend WebAssembly is a fad or a phase. It's been around for 5 years now. It's exploding in popularity, and it truly is something you will need to know about. There are tool chains that we'll talk about later that explain what I mean about the death of JavaScript. LinkedIn will be asking for about 5 years of programming WebAssembly experience in about 6 months. And this is such a big thing that you cannot ignore it in the long run. I cannot stress that enough. So let's talk a little bit about what WebAssembly is. WebAssembly is a compilation target for other languages to compile to, as well as a language in itself. You can write WebAssembly code, but you can also compile to it in other languages. This can forever change how we code for the browser. It's an augmentation of the abilities of JavaScript by allowing other languages to operate in the browser. But most importantly, WebAssembly is pretty literally magic. Not really literally, but I'll explain later. So WebAssembly is a compilation target. You write code in other languages and compile them into WebAssembly. Rust, C++, Go, C#. These are just a few of the languages that WebAssembly has as a compile target. There are more and more languages growing by the day, and you can check those out at Awesome WASM Languages. But then the first question you have to ask about WebAssembly is, what? Why? Why would you do this? Why would you create a way for other languages to run on the web? We've done this before with Java applets. We've done this before with Flash. Why would you do this? So there are so many reasons you would want this in your life, and there's so many things that make WebAssembly different. For one, there are no extensions to the browser that you have to install, no third-party software that you have to install. WebAssembly runs natively in the browser. So that's a huge step forward from Java applets and Flash applications. Another thing is it's the programming languages you already know compiled into WebAssembly, and so you can run the languages that you already know. And I truly believe that this is a new era for the web. This is the dawning of a new kind of epoch for the web in development, and similar to Ajax, similar to serverless in server-side development, similar to Node in server-side development. I think this is a benchmark. And you may look at me like, yeah, okay, Kassian, I don't know. No, but seriously, WebAssembly is comparable to bringing the power of the analogous to the JVM into the browser, creating an evolution of the web as we know it. So instead of bringing the JVM out from an external service, what I mean is because we have these compile targets that a lot of different languages can aim for, it's similar, it's analogous to the JVM. It's not entirely similar. So you can compare LLVM to tool chains like WASM, Pack, and Blazor. Okay, now you're like, what? Okay, I need more of an explanation here. So let's talk about how the web used to work. I call this ancient.png. On the left, you have a browser, and in it sits HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, which really was just, making things trail the cursor or alert web windows that would pop up or playing MP3s automatically when you joined a page. And then on the server, literally everything was over on the server. You would click the link, it would return a page. You would click a link, it would return a page. That was how things worked. Then came Ajax. It was the sparkly new toy, and what it did is you request a page, you got a page, but then you could make an Ajax request and parse in the result. Make an Ajax request and parse in the result. And so that really made things change. It made the server change. Of course, there are still servers where everything is over there, but you've also got REST APIs with HTML, CSS, and JS static file servers. You've got serverless. You've got all sorts of different architectures because of Ajax. Now, I truly believe that this is the now.png. We now have service workers, and we now have WebAssembly, and you can use WebAssembly to compute things in the browser that you wouldn't normally want to do with JavaScript. You can use service workers to get third-party modules, and then you still use Ajax, and the server can be serverless. It can be, you can just have an application that works in the browser. You don't necessarily need all that technology on the server because we're moving more capability into the browser. Between service workers and WebAssembly, we can do so much so quickly in the browser. The server in this picture is just as likely a cluster of serverless functions. Okay, now you're kind of with me. Now you're like, all right, let's do this. Like, why do I care though? Like, this is great, but why do I care? This matters because it augments JavaScript at its not so strong points. It means not rewriting entire code bases to use them on the web. And it means fewer calls to the server, less latency, and faster web applications. So let's talk about augmenting JavaScript and its not so strong points. Who wants to write a banking app in JavaScript? Not a lot of people, I'd wager. If you're running anything that relies on mathematical numerical accuracy or speed that meant until now another Ajax call to have another language do all the math. With WebAssembly, we can do this in the browser with, say, Rust or C++ or another language that is much better at math. Other JS not so strong points. You've got type coercion side effects, and yes, you can tell me all you want about TypeScript, but this is a different technology than TypeScript. You've also got accidental concats, things like that, type of array. WebAssembly means, at the end of the day, using the right tool for the job. If that means using JavaScript, that means using JavaScript. If that means using another language, WebAssembly, that's what that means. This doesn't mean that we're going to get rid of JavaScript, though. This will not necessarily kill JS, which is what I'm hearing a lot of people say out loud right now. And I say this with all the love in the world, and no one ever quotes me with the first part, but let me say the full quote. With all the love in the world, I say that JavaScript is the cockroach of languages. It will just keep coming back. And a bunch of people are going to quote me on this again, and it's fine, but please say with love, I love JavaScript. But it won't die because of WebAssembly. But there are some people who would like it to happen, and WASM is gaining more and more abilities by the day. There are WebAssembly modules that can access the DOM and be used to manipulate the DOM. But for most situations, it makes JavaScript better by letting it do what it is good at and ignoring the rest. We are waltzing towards the showdown between those who would have WASM do everything and those who would have WASM as an augmentation. You can contact me later if you'd like to learn even more about that situation. But WebAssembly, in the end of the day, makes the web better by creating better browser experiences. You have faster browser experiences. You have fewer calls to the server. You have less latency. You can do more math. You can do one of the first WebAssembly demos was running a 3D game. I believe it was, what was it? Anyway, it was a 3D game that was very popular on the PC, and it was ported to the browser using WebAssembly, well, ASM.js, which is the predecessor to WebAssembly. And so being able to do 3D gaming and things like that in the browser without an external plugin is definitely a huge leap forward. But let's take a closer look with a demo. The demo uses WASM Image Magic, which is the image magic library that many of you may have heard. It's the CLI tool that allows you to manipulate images and do all sorts of cool stuff to them. And it manipulates images in the browser up to 10 times faster than JavaScript can. That's a very conservative estimate. Some of these things JavaScript can't even really do properly, much less do speedily. This demo shows the real power of not having to rewrite code and being able to let us use the right tool for the job. So with that, we'll take a look at the demo and I'll walk you through it. Okay, so this is the Image Magic demo. What I've got here is VS Code, and let me make this a little bigger for y'all. There we go. So what I'm going to show you first is my index.html file. What I've got is a bunch of buttons and a bunch of divs, and what we're going to do is we're going to take an image and we're going to manipulate it with WASM Image Magic. And as you can see down here, I've got dist/main.js. What that consists of is app.js and importing from WASM Image Magic. Now, you cannot use the HTML tags yet to bring in WASM modules. You have to bring them in using ES6 package syntax, but that is being actively worked on as we speak. It may actually have been fixed since the last time I spoke on this subject. So, but for now, ES6 modules are the way to go. So what we're doing is we're setting up a canvas, and we're actually getting a video selector because we'll be able to take a picture with a webcam and alter that. So that's the trigger photo take, which is, it has to do with the webcam. Now here's where we get in, things get interesting. We're going to determine manipulation array, and when rotate right, it's basically setting the CLI commands for the image magic tool. So you've got rotate 90, rotate negative 90, set color space linear gray, add contrast, minus contrast, blur, and then you've got a multi that does a few different things. So we take the manipulation array, and we're going to wait magic.call source file.png content source bytes, which is down here under start manipulation. What it does is it loads the canvas into a series of source bytes, which then is loaded into image magic. And so we've got a buffer of bytes that represents our image, and it will be loaded into image magic, and the image magic spits out the modified version of bytes, the modified buffer of bytes, and then we'll spit that back out onto the screen. So to run this, what we're gonna do is we're gonna go over to the terminal, and we're in my demo, and we're going to run just a simple HTTP server. Oops, if I can type. There we go. All right, and so we're going to go into the browser, and we're going to close these tabs, and we're going to open up the demo. And I always look silly in photos, so I'm going to look silly on my terms. Oh, looking at the wrong camera. Let's try that again. There we go. So what I'm going to do is rotate right. You can see that there. And rotate left. But those are things that CSS can do. You might be thinking, come on, Kassian, show me something that CSS can't do and that JavaScript has trouble with. Let's check grayscale. See how fast that is? Add contrast. Remove contrast. Blur. And then multi makes a blurred grayscale. So that is the magic of WebAssembly in the browser. You can see this is being manipulated super quickly, and I'll pull up another image and do the same thing here. So we've got multi, got just blur, contrast, add, grayscale, left, right. Now here's where I show you that this isn't anything going on the server. I'm actually going to close my server here. So my HTTP server is stopped. When I tell it to rotate left, or grayscale, or add contrast, or remove contrast, or blur, and then I can tell it to take my picture again. You can still do that, and it can still run multi. So that is the best way I know of to show the power of WebAssembly. It also works really well for offline applications. I can't turn my Wi-Fi off right now due to reasons, but when I do this demo, I turn the Wi-Fi off and I continue to run the application to prove that it's not, you know, running on some sort of third-party magic. It is strictly running in the browser using WebAssembly. So with that, let's go back to the slides. So that was cool. It was a great way to see what happens in the browser when we add WebAssembly. Now you might be thinking, what about Node.js? Wait, what about Node.js? We were just talking about the web. Does this affect Node.js? Can it affect Node.js? It can. And one way I can think of is native Heccin modules. Brian Cranston's saying fudge, and I believe him, because native Heccin modules are a real issue. If you've never had a native module compilation blow up on you during a Node module install, you are one of the luckiest people on the planet. So why are native modules such a pain? Native modules, for those who are new to that, is when you allow C and C++ code or any sort of native code to be compiled into an NPM module. They have to be compiled on download for the architecture you're installing on, be that a Raspberry Pi all the way up to the newest MacBooks. You have to recompile every time you're installing. And they either have to compile on every platform or leave platforms off from support. And much like saying, this only works in Chrome, that doesn't always fly when you have a module that only works on Mac or only works on Windows. Node.jip is something that's, to be fair, it's an extremely important piece of technology and really well written, and I respect the Node.jip team, but it's so tricky. Right now, when you NPMI your native modules, they download and compile the source on your machine. And that takes a lot of time, and that takes a lot of PC power, and it can run into a lot of problems. So let's talk about a possible solution. WebAssembly works on Node greater than 8.0. 8.0 is past its long-term release window, so every long-term release window of Node has support for WebAssembly. So it's just a mental math here. we have these modules that have to be recompiled every time that they're downloaded. And we have these Node modules that are in different languages. And we have support for WebAssembly and Node. So all that together means WebAssembly modules can be used in Node.js. They're precompiled binaries, so they're portable to any platform that runs Node.js. No more compilation on every download or every architecture. For reals. When I downloaded Wasm Image Magic, I did it through NPM install, and it didn't have to compile anything. It just stuck the precompiled WebAssembly into my Node modules folder. That is true of any WebAssembly module. It is precompiled, so you don't have to recompile it. And it runs anywhere that Node runs, so you don't have to worry about what architecture you're running on. Because as long as Node runs on it, WebAssembly will run on it. WebAssembly is even invading the serverless space. Cloudflare Workers, for instance, runs on the V8 engine, so it supports JavaScript and any language that can be targeted to Node to WebAssembly. So essentially, it runs JavaScript and WebAssembly. We do have a free tier, which I'm showing the QR code for now. I'll show this again later. Basically, it allows you to do several functions and many, many calls a day for free, and you get your own subdomain of workers.dev, which is a lot of fun. How do we get to this magical WebAssembly land? If you'd like to learn Rust, you can read the Rust book and the Rust Wasm book. Those are the two that I find most user-friendly. I really like Rust a lot. I've been playing around with it a bunch, and it's really interesting. If you'd like to use C or C++, check out mscripten. That is the most prevalent toolchain for C and C++. And if you're a C# fan, Blazor, B-L-A-Z-O-R, is the toolchain for you. Also, the streamer C# Fritz has been doing a lot of work with Blazor lately, so if you want to see some really cool Twitch streams with some WebAssembly, I would check out C# Fritz. So what's the point of this talk? The point of this talk is to get you to try WebAssembly. I personally like Rust, but whichever language fits you, go ahead and try it. WebAssembly is the future of JavaScript in all of its forms. It's the augmentation of JS that allows the browser to truly kind of come into its own. And finally, if you're a hiring manager and you're hiring right now, I would like you to hire someone who's different from you. Just go do it. I know it's a challenge, but as Shia LaBeouf very famously said, just do it. Please. It's for the good of our community and the good of our industry. Thank you so much for listening to this talk. I will leave you with a Carl Sagan quote. All inquiries carry some element of risk. There is no guarantee that the universe will conform to our predispositions, but I do not see how we can deal with the universe, both the inside and outside universe, without studying it. The best way to avoid abuses is for the populace in general to be scientifically literate, to understand the implications of such investigations. In exchange for freedom of inquiry, scientists are obliged to explain their work. If science is considered a closed priesthood, too difficult and arcane for the average person to understand, the dangers of abuse are greater. But if science is a topic of general interest and concern, in both its delights and its social consequences, are gathered regularly and competently in the schools, the press, and discussed at the dinner table, we will have greatly improved our prospects for learning how the world really is and for improving both it and us. The QR code for the free version of Workers is also on the screen. You can reach me at cass@cloudflare.com or at nodebotanist at just about every social platform you can think of. Thank you again so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it, and I hope you have a great rest of your week.